Welcome to the second of a series of four lectures on the thought of Sigmund Freud. You will recall that last week I spent virtually the entire lecture talking about Freud's most important discovery, the discovery that shaped his entire life's work, the discovery of the unconscious. And I told you that what Freud found, which was puzzling, was that patients resisted what he had discovered about their unconscious thoughts, even though the discovery of those unconscious thoughts relieved them of their symptomology, relieved them of the pain that they were suffering. Now, that's not a normal sort of thing. Ordinarily, you don't resist a doctor when the doctor undertakes to cure your pain. Now, for example, a year and a half ago, I was in excruciating agony in my arms and legs for about 2 months until I went to a new doctor who took one look at me and said, "You have polymyalgia rheumatica." I'd never heard of it. He said, "You have to take prednisone." Okay, I took prednisone. 2 days later, I was pain-free. I did not go back to him and say, "I refuse to accept the proposition that I have polymyalgia rheumatica. You'll have to find something else wrong with me." I was slavishly grateful. Now, there are times when the doctor says, "You got to stop eating cheeseburgers and fries and start eating fruits and vegetables, and you have to walk a little bit every day." Well, so you resist that. You resist it even though you know he's right, but you don't tell him, "I refuse to accept that proposition." But Freud's patients denied what he was discovering under hypnosis or in other ways, which I'll describe in a moment. And that was a peculiar fact. So Freud undertook a lifelong examination of the unconscious. Now, you'll remember that I said that Freud had five questions which had been posed, and Alex will now pan my little camcorder over to the chart that I had made up at Staples, God bless them. The first question was, why is it so difficult for patients to access the unconscious ideas and by accessing them to relieve the symptoms? So let me talk about that. Freud, you will recall, I told you, was a neurologist. And through his entire life, he assumed that there was some neurological explanation, some physical neurological explanation for everything that he discovered. But he had no way of identifying it because he had none of the modern tools that we use today. So what Freud did was to give an anthropomorphic explanation. I'm going to use that explanation because it's the only way I can talk about Freud's work. But you have to remember that always when I use this anthropomorphic explanation, I am assuming, as Freud did, that eventually, possibly, one could find a neurological basis for it. Freud said, between the unconscious and the conscious minds, there is a censor, a guardian, who stands guard at the gateway between the unconscious and the conscious and stops the unconscious thoughts from breaking into consciousness. Now, this introduces a notion which was quite revolutionary, namely that the mind, that there was a dynamic structure of the mind. It took energy to repress these unconscious ideas, ideas that were trying to get to consciousness, but which the censor was denying access to the conscious mind. And so Freud asked the question, what can I do to get access to the unconscious ideas, to get past the censor? And very early in his career, he hit upon the idea of looking at dreams. Now, two things about this looking at dreams which are interesting. First, this was not a new idea. People had been talking about dreams for 2,500 years at least. Dreams were thought of as messages from the spirit world. They were thought of as predictions of the future. People had great many theories about what dreams were and what their significance was. Serious scientists said, no, dreams are simply a consequence of physical conditions during sleep, if your bedclothes are too tight around you, or if it's a little chilly or something of the sort, that triggers these unconscious thoughts. But people have been talking about dreams for a long time, and if you read Freud's most important book, The Interpretation of Dreams, you'll discover that the whole first long chapter is a survey of what everybody else had said about dreams, things that Freud thought were unsatisfactory, but which he was quite well aware of. The second thing is equally interesting, to me at any rate. Freud's focus on dreams, and also, as I mentioned last time, on jokes and slips of the tongue, were an instance of a general movement which was taking place in intellectual work in the Western world over the preceding century and a half. A movement that consisted progressively in looking at elements of human experience that had been considered beneath the dignity of serious observers, infra dignitate, as the Romans would say. Literature and history and general discussions of human affairs had focused on elevated people and events, on kings and queens and emperors and empresses and princes and princesses, on wars, on battles, on the fall of one regime and the rise of another regime, on that sort of thing. Now, there was also a sub-literature of attention to lower class doings, always in the comic mode. So in Shakespeare's plays, for example, you even in the very serious plays, you will have scenes in which there are lower class characters who are presented as comic, never as tragic, never as highly serious. I'll make a reference to something that has nothing to do with this. If you're interested in pursuing this subject, there is a simply spectacularly good book which I recommend to you no matter what your field of interest. It's Erich Auerbach's classic work, Mimesis. I won't say more than that because it would take me a whole lecture to talk about it, but look it up, find it, read it. It is one of the great works of humanist scholarship in the Western world. At any rate, in the late 18th century, people started to pay close attention to aspects of human experience that before then had gone more or less unanalyzed by serious investigators. The first thing that happened was that a group of people whom we call economists started looking at behavior in the marketplace, buying and selling, what Adam Smith famously called the higgling and jiggling of the marketplace. Now, everybody knew that people bought and sold things in the marketplace. Every day they went to the market, whether it was the Agora of ancient Athens or some other market, and bought and sold. But they didn't think it was worthy of study. And what the economists did was actually to make a science out of the study of this debased material, this buying and selling. They formulated theories. They had mathematical analyses of this activity of buying and selling. Somewhat later, another great 19th century student of human affairs, E.B. Tyler, took a look at the reports of voyages into the South Pacific and these fascinating accounts that people brought back of strange people not wearing many clothes, who had odd practices and worshiped strange gods, and so forth. And he formulated a notion which was quite revolutionary, namely that they had culture, that culture was not only the possession of the upper classes, people had thought that way for thousands of years, but that these ordinary people, primitive savages, not even Christian, had a culture of their own. And he wrote a very large two-volume work called Primitive Culture, which in effect gave birth to the discipline of anthropology, in which he took seriously this notion that every group of people had a collection of practices, material practices, religious practices, kinship relationships, linguistic practices, which constituted as a whole their culture. So the notion of the study of these as a serious study came into Western thought. A little bit later on, Emil Durkheim took a group of statistics about suicide, a subject that nobody thought was worth study, and invented out of it the field of sociology. The same thing happened in literature. For a long time, the only modes of literature that were taken seriously were tragedy, Greek comedy, and poetry, especially high poetry of the metaphysical sort and so forth. Novels, which were born in the 18th century and became a very popular amusement in the 19th century, were not considered appropriate objects for study. They were just things to do when you weren't doing your serious study. And I think I'm right in saying that not until well into the 20th century was it possible actually at Oxford or Cambridge to study the novel as a subject. Well, once the novel had been taken up by literary critics and made a serious object of study, then they started studying what they called film, what the rest of us call movies. And after they had made an art, a subject of literary investigation out of film, they turned their attention to comic books. I mean, little by little, elements of human experience which had been considered beneath the level of serious investigation came to be the object of organized serious inquiry and to have serious books written about them. Freud was continuing this practice, in effect, by focusing on dreams and jokes and slips of the tongue. These were elements of human experience that everybody was familiar with, but that nobody thought you could theorize about. Now, there's a problem with dreams, if you think about it. You're never awake when you have them. So nobody ever has direct access to a dream. It's always a memory of a dream. You wake up and you remember a dream. Well, that's the first problem. The problem is, can you remember your dreams, and are your recollections of your dreams accurate? There is, leaving aside doing an MRI and seeing which parts of your brain light up, which Freud couldn't do, there is no way at all, save the narrative of the patient, to find out what the patient's dreams were. That's the first problem. The second problem with dreams is that if anybody who thinks seriously about them will realize, dreams are very chaotic, jerky, strange. They go from one subject to another. Odd things pop up in them. This is a real problem, because when people tell you their dreams, they have a natural, almost irresistible tendency to put them in the form of a narrative, to take the elements that they remember from the dream and make a story out of them. An interesting story, a sad story, a frightening story, an exciting story, but a story with a beginning, a middle, an end, and characters, and so forth. And that's not what dreams are actually like, if you actually pay attention to them. Dreams jump around, and we very often remember only fragments of dreams. If you ask people to tell you their dreams, quite often they will remember one striking thing about the dream, and then they'll say, well, I can't remember the rest of it. Or they'll say, well, I was walking in a field and suddenly I found myself in the middle of a big city. That sort of thing. So Freud was convinced that dreams were expressions of unconscious thoughts. His theory was that at night, the sensor nods off. The sensor is not as alert as he is during the day. Remember that in dreams, no matter how exciting they are, no matter how remarkable the things that you're doing, you're actually just lying in bed. You're not doing anything. So they're not a threat in the way that they would be if these unconscious thoughts burst into consciousness when you were awake and going about in the world. So the theory was that the sensor relaxes a little bit, nods off, and allows some of these unconscious thoughts to get into the realm, into the dream world. Although, as I'll describe later on, maybe in the next lecture, the dreams are transformed. The elements of the dreams are transformed in all sorts of striking ways. And so Freud conceived the idea of trying to get at the dreams and at the ideas that were being manifested in the dreams by having the patient not merely tell the dream to Freud, but to tell Freud what he or she associated to different elements in the dream. Now, Freud didn't ask the patient, tell me your dream as a story, because he knew that was a mistake. They would eliminate things that seemed irrelevant, they would add things that they needed to make sense out of it, and they would produce a story which was not the dream. So what Freud did was not to have them associate to the dream as a whole, but to associate to each different element in the dream. And by associate, I mean Freud, in effect, made a pact with his patients. He said, now, I want you to tell me a dream, and now I'll pick this element. I want you to tell me anything that comes to mind without editing it, without being afraid to say it, without being fearful that you will embarrass yourself or that you will offend me or that you will say something inappropriate. Just say whatever comes to mind. This is not easy to do, by the way. I mean, you have to develop the ability to free associate. It's not something most people do easily and freely. Now, I have to say, it's a little hard talking about this now in a time when young people play truth or dare and things like that. But remember, we're talking about the Viennese equivalent of Victorian England. I mean, it's the same period of time. And the upper middle class, the bourgeoisie of Vienna, were just as stuffy and stifled and proper and repressed as their counterparts in London. So getting a young, well-brought up, polite, prim Viennese woman of 25 or 30 to say anything that came into her mind in response to an association to an element of a dream took a lot of work. I'll say a word now about how Freud thought to accomplish this. I was going to talk about it later, but it fits in here. Since dreams are part of what happens to us when we are asleep, Freud thought if he had the patient recline on a couch in a darkened examining room, and if Freud himself sat in such a way that the patient couldn't see him, then perhaps the patient would relax enough and to be able to associate to the dream elements. See, the problem is when you talk to somebody else looking at them, you are picking up in a thousand different ways body language cues, changes in facial expression. You are interacting with the person. And one of the things you're doing, of course, all the time is seeing whether you are keeping your interlocutor interested, whether you're saying something that shocks your interlocutor, whether you're going off topic. You are engaged in a social interaction at the adult level, but that's not what Freud wanted. So he got himself, Freud actually talked more than analysts do these days, but he was just getting started and he was interested in what he had to say, so you can't blame him entirely. But Freud would sit so that the patient couldn't see him. He would keep himself quiet and he would ask the patient to start free associating to an element in a dream. And he would see where that would run as a way of hoping that little by little some element of the unconscious that was being repressed by the sensor would pop out. Let me give you an example. This is a personal example. At about 3:30 this morning, I was lying. When you get to be my age, you wake up a lot in the middle of the night, ostensibly to go to the bathroom, but actually I just never sleep eight hours. But I spend 8 hours in bed, but I wake up a lot. So at 3:30, I was lying awake, and I was thinking about, half conscious, I was thinking about giving this lecture. And I remembered a dream that I had just had. It was a dream in which I was in a room with people. It seemed that there was somebody in charge of the room. I didn't know what was happening, but he was handing out little leather packets that had snaps, and you could open it up. Now, the leather was very, very soft, and it was very, very pliable. And as I was lying there half awake, I thought, sort of like a scrotum. And then I thought, you could open this up, and inside were these things that you use on these whiteboards that you have here. When I grew up, nobody had whiteboards. They had blackboards. You wrote on it with a piece of chalk, and then you erased it, and then you had to knock the erasers to get the chalk out of the eraser, and it was a great mess. Now you have these whiteboards. When I first gave a series of lectures on the Critique of Pure Reason some while ago, I went to Staples and I bought a packet of these magic markers that you use on whiteboards, and it came in a plastic container with a snap, and I thought, yes, it was like a snap. And then I thought to myself that it was like that. It was, and I inside this are these firm, strong magic markers that you can write on the board with. And then I thought to myself, the reason why I did that is that as I've grown old, my fingers have gotten sort of a little bit arthritic, and my handwriting has gone all to hell. And I can't write big, strong, bold letters anymore. Instead, I write crabbed little letters that I can hardly read. I can't even read my own handwriting. And that's why I got these things. And then I thought, You know what, and then what I thought of, I didn't say it was like that, my mind associated to the fact that at the age of 83, I suffer from what Bob Dole, in a famous advertisement, called erectile dysfunction, ED, the inability to maintain an erection. And that was what the dream was about. Now, at this point, I'm sure there are people watching this video who are saying, ugh, gross, good God, Wolf, why don't you go back to talking about serious stuff? Ugh, that's more than I want to know about your personal life. Why am I telling you this? Because this is exactly what Freud did. And people in Vienna in the late 19th and early 20th century had exactly that reaction to what he said he was discovering. We think now of Freud as a world-famous historical figure with a beard looking very serious in his late 70s or whatever. But in fact, Freud was a young man trying to get a medical practice started, trying to support a young family, and he was reporting things that people were shocked and appalled by. I mean, he was banned from certain medical conferences. He couldn't speak at them because of the things he was saying. And with enormous courage, Freud went on talking about these things. Now, what did Freud discover? Well, Freud discovered several things that completely changed his understanding of the human mind and of the unconscious. The first thing he discovered, which I'm sure you can all guess, was that as he worked with his patients, remember, 5, 6, 7, 8 hours a day, he didn't just do this once or twice, he did it day after day for his whole life. Again and again and again, when patients free associated to elements of their dreams, they would find themselves associating to things with a sexual connotation. That, surprise, Freud talked about sex. But nobody else was talking about sex then, and especially not in ordinary German, rather in Latin or something like that. You remember when I brought my copy of The Interpretation of Dreams to the last lecture, I opened it at the front, and this was the A.A. Brill 1913 translation, and there's a little piece of paper pasted inside which said, this sale of this book is limited to the clerical, legal, learned, and medical professions. Nobody but doctors and lawyers should be reading this stuff, certainly not ordinary people. So the first thing that he discovered was that he kept coming on sexual themes. The second thing, which was in its way even more surprising and more important, was that again and again and again, what his patients were remembering as they associated to their dreams were things that had happened to them when they were little children. Not things that had happened last week or last month, but things that had happened 20 or 25 or 30 years earlier. And this was mysterious for several reasons. The first reason was, the most important was, that these thoughts, judging as he could from their associations and their dreams, were as powerful now as they had been when they were little children. Now that's a very peculiar phenomenon. All of us are familiar with the experience of having some very powerful thing, some terrifying thing, or gratifying thing, or exciting thing happen, some terrible thing like the loss of a loved one, which over time softens and begins, the affect begins to die away. In the god-awful language of the soaps, we move on. But his patients, it seemed, the unconscious wasn't moving on. The conscious mind was, the people in the conscious world were, but in their unconscious, these ideas had as much power when they were 25 or 30 as they had when they were 4 or 5. And that was a clue to Freud that the unconscious operates with rules and laws that are totally different from the rules and laws of the conscious mind. As Freud went on, he began to discover something very, very troubling. Now you understand, medical doctors are accustomed to seeing bad stuff. I mean, they see terrible wounds, they see dying patients, they see patients with grotesque deformities, they see patients who have suffered terrible injuries. So they're accustomed to that sort of thing. But one after another, the polite young adult bourgeois ladies whom he was treating for their various symptoms and disabilities would report with dreams and with the association with dreams, would remember finally that as little girls they had been sexually abused by their fathers. Well, I mean, once again, you have to think back. We're talking nowadays, people would likely say, but then, you know, so what else is new? Not in Vienna in the 1890s or the 1900s. The notion that there was a rash of child abusers in the polite bourgeois world of Viennese society was absolutely unacceptable. It was shocking. And when Freud reported it in his written works, there was an outcry against it. After a while, Freud made an extraordinary discovery, a discovery that completely transformed his understanding of the way the unconscious works. He realized that what he was hearing was not memories of experiences that these little girls had had, but memories of desires that they had had, of wishes. Well, that got the fathers off the hook. But if there was anything worse than the notion that middle-class Viennese society was a collection of child sexual molesters, it was the notion that these delightful, charming little angels in their crinolines were hot for papa and were sexed up at the age of 5 and 6. That was, if anything, even more unacceptable. And Freud, out of this realization, which Freud, I mean, notice, Freud was quite prepared, having gotten all sorts of flack for saying that Vienna was full of polite gentlemen abusing their 6-year-old daughters. Freud was quite prepared to say, no, I was wrong. They aren't abusing their 6-year-old daughters. Their 6-year-old daughters are lusting after them at the age of 6. The guy had guts. You got to give that to him. And he stuck with, I mean, he was prepared to change his views when the evidence caused him to change his views. This is one of the many ways in which he was unlike, say, a philosopher, if you forgive me for saying so. At any rate, Freud eventually began to develop the hypothesis that the unconscious was filled with exceedingly powerful, infantile wishes that remained as powerful in the adult as they were in the child, but were now being repressed by the censor because they were, in Freud's marvelously archaic term, unacceptable thoughts. That was what he said of them. These were unacceptable ideas, and therefore they were repressed by the censor. And so he began to develop the notion of the unconscious as a realm of wishes which erupted into dreams, which were expressed in dreams, and which at the same time were so unacceptable in the adult polite world that they were repressed. Now there's an implication here which I'm going to spell out at much greater length in the next lecture, which I want to call your attention to. The implication was that even in a fully rational adult, a person who could function well in the real world and so forth, there is a structure of consciousness with a layer of infantile wishes which remain powerful and don't die away, and which are governed by rules of reason and understanding utterly different from those that govern adult rational interactions with the world, and that the mind, and so that the mind of a rational agent, somebody who makes sensible choices and pursues a career and has a family and does all sorts of things like that, is actually comes into existence on top of this cauldron of powerful wishes which could date from childhood and never go away. That's a very strange concept of the structure of the mind, and it is a serious challenge to anyone who thinks that human beings are rational. because what this says is that rationality is a secondary formation. It's not the natural way for human beings to be. And so Freud embarked on this, as Bettelheim, I told you last week, said, on this ceaseless quest for the unconscious, to understand in its full details the structure of the unconscious, and most importantly, remember, the ways in which this produced painful symptoms and disabilities in his adult patients. Now you notice, as I mentioned last time, Freud was unable, or never made any effort, to access those infantile wishes and desires directly by looking at little children. He didn't study little children. He was treating, not studying, but treating adult patients. And everything he had to say about the structure of the mind and this realm of infantile wishes came through an interpretation of what his adult patients were telling him. He also made a secondary effort. Dreams was the main technique that he used, but he had a secondary effort interpreting slips of the tongue and jokes. Slips of the tongue he interpreted as moments when the censor nods, as it were, and something slips through. Now, if you go read Freud, I just want to warn you, he was not Lenny Bruce. Freud was a proper Viennese gentleman, and he had the sort of sense of humor that you'd expect somebody like that would have. His jokes, the jokes that he analyzed, were not real knee slappers. But nevertheless, I mean, the one slip of the tongue that I remember he makes much of is a meeting of some parliament somewhere in Vienna or elsewhere in the Habsburg Empire, where the person who was chairing the meeting, in an attempt to call it to attention and get it started, lifted his gavel and said, "I now declare this meeting closed, open." Well, pretty clearly he wanted it to be closed, and so he blurted out closed. Remember last week when I was talking glibly about Freud, I suddenly mentioned Kant instead of Freud. All right, doesn't take a psychoanalyst to figure out that I would rather have been talking about Kant than Freud. I would always rather be talking about Kant than Freud. But that just says something weird about me, which it would take a long time to explain. At any rate, the same way what jokes do, he said, is to give expression to otherwise unacceptable wishes in a form that makes them the object of humor and therefore acceptable. And so he didn't think that you could make a great deal out of jokes and slips of the tongue, but he actually wrote a short book about them, in the purpose of which was to show the different ways in which the unconscious erupts into consciousness. Well, that answers, in effect, the first two questions. The third question, what is the content of the unconscious? What can we learn about what resides in the unconscious? I've started talking about. That's an enormous subject. Let me say a bit more about dreams, because they were such an important part of Freud's work. What Freud discovered was, in getting his patients to free associate to the elements, to the different elements of a dream, was that very often there was a kind of concealment even in the dreams. That is to say, the element in the dream to which the patient had the most associations and which the patient reported as being most powerfully emotionally affective were elements which in the recounting of the dream seemed quite trivial. I mean, I'll make up an example. Suppose I have a dream in which in the dream, I encounter an enormous, fearful dragon, a real frightful dragon, which, oddly enough, in the dream, I'm not afraid of at all. Standing next to the dragon, almost off the scene, is an innocent little boy, and I'm terrified of that innocent little boy. When I associate to that element, out come all sorts of fears, whereas the dragon, which is traditionally and conventionally terrifying, is something that I'm not afraid of at all. This sort of thing happens all the time in dreams. Now, there are also all sorts of verbal games and tricks that are played in dreams. Freud's name, you can imagine, the word Freud in German means joy. Well, it doesn't take a lot of brains to figure out what his patients would make out of that. But what Freud found, and this is crucially important, is that there's no lexicon of the meanings of different elements of a dream, phallic symbols and so forth and so on. You can't tell what a dream means to a patient in that dream without the free associations, because without the associations you cannot find out what that element means. I mean, in the dream that I recounted to you, who would imagine that for me the little packet of magic markers that I got from Staples would be associated with erectile dysfunction. I mean, you could put that in a book and that would never come up again in anybody's dream. So you can't do dream analysis from afar. You can't get somebody to send you, you know, if you can't come in and you don't have the money to pay for a whole session, write down your dream and send it to me and I'll write back and tell you what it means. You can't do that. You can't even do that once you've had a patient under treatment for a long time, because the next time it may have a different set of associations. So that only through the actual process in the therapeutic situation of the association could you find out, could you get at the unconscious elements. Furthermore, as I said some while ago, in order for the process of free association to work, it's necessary for the patient to, as it were, enter into a pact with the doctor, to agree to say whatever comes into his or her mind without editing it, without correcting it, without putting it into a story or blocking it and giving something else instead. That's hard. It's actually hard as a technique. You have to learn to do that as a technique. But what's more, you have to be willing to do it, even if you find it embarrassing. And Freud would do everything he could. He was non-judgmental, because it was not, the only way he could get, I mean, the censor was already being judgmental. The censor was already repressing what it considered to be unacceptable ideas. In order to get at those, you had to allow the process of free association to flow. And the analyst had to be quite sensitive to this process. Sometimes, for example, a patient would start associating and then stop. And if the analyst says, go on, the patient might say, that's it, that's all I can, that's all that comes to mind. There is nothing else. In a kind of belligerent and defensive way. Another time, the patient is associating and associates and associates and then stops. And the doctor says, go on. And the patient says, that's it. There doesn't seem to be anything else. There's a difference between those two responses. One of them suggests that repression and editing is taking place. The other suggests that the process of association has just run out. Freud discovered something else, which, for those of you who are devotees of Althusser's interpretation of Marx, you may find interesting. Althusser, God bless him, misunderstands Marx in various ways, but that's in part because apparently he never really read him very seriously. But that's for another series of lectures. Some of you, if you are mathematicians, will be familiar with the notion of overdetermination or underdetermination. If you have a set of linear equations, and you have more equations than you have unknowns, the system of equations is said to be underdetermined, and you can't solve it because there aren't enough. Did I get that right? No, I got it backwards. Damn it, I always do that. Something to learn if you're going in for a career of teaching. Always write these things down and make sure they're right before you bring them into class, because sure as God made little apples, you get them wrong and then you feel like an idiot. So here I am feeling like an idiot. If there are more unknowns than there are equations, then the system is said to be underdetermined. But sometimes you have more equations than you have unknowns, and then the system is said to be overdetermined. And in fact, it can only be solved consistently if the equations are not linearly independent of one another. Okay, why do I mention that? Because Freud introduced the notion of overdetermination in the analysis of dreams. Sometimes he discovered that in having the patient make a series of free associations to different elements in the dream could be entirely analyzed through a series of associations into the meaning, the emotional meaning, the memories, the wishes associated with different elements of the dream. And then it would turn out that there was a second set of associations for the same elements, which yielded an equally correct, equally adequate alternative account. The dream was overdetermined. It was it. What the mind had done was to take two entirely separate complexes of powerful repressed wishes and combine them and express them in a single dream. And I mean, what Althusser did was to confuse the notion of overdetermination with the notion of multiple determination. That's neither. I once had a big argument with two marvelous Marxists at University of Massachusetts, Steve Resnick and Rick Wolf, about this subject. I was sitting in on their class, and they were devotees of Althusser, and they started talking about overdetermination. And I raised my hand and I said, "Excuse me, I think you're confusing it with multiple determination." After several tense moments, it became clear that I was disrupting the class. So I did the only reasonable thing. I left and didn't go back to the class because it was their class and I wasn't there to make trouble. I just thought I would clear up a confusion. But I wasn't clearing up a confusion. I was challenging the foundations of their life's work, and so they weren't too thrilled. So I left. At any rate, but I can now say freely, having been retired from the university for 9 years now, I was right and they were wrong. What does it cost, right? All right. But what Freud found was that over and over and over again, dreams were in some way the expressions of wishes, infantile wishes. Now, that raises an odd question, because very often what is remembered is a painful or terrifying wish. And the question is, or it's a wish for something that's painful or terrifying, and the question is, why, how can you call that a wish? Well, once again, I will speak personally. I do this partly because I think in another age, in another culture, I would have been a striptease dancer. But aside from that, because the only way to illustrate what Freud was doing is to talk about it personally, not talk about it as though it were biology or something. When I was a teenage boy, I suffered from obsessive and compulsive fears of death. Indeed, they sent me into therapy. And the therapy must have worked because the fears subsided, but I never found out what the cause of them was, except that sometimes when I was lying in bed, obsessed by this fear of death, which, by the way, was not a fear of injury, it was not a fear of old age, it was a fear of non-being, just the fear of non-being, I would sometimes experience a moment of relief by telling myself, maybe I'll die before it happens. That's weird. And it didn't take much brains to figure out that the fear of death was a cover for something that I was afraid of worse than death. And that the fear of death was a way of concealing from myself what I was really afraid of. So that I would say, maybe I'll die before it happens, because dying would be better than having it happen. What was it? Well, you have to read my book on the Critique of Pure Reason to find that out, as my psychoanalyst pointed out to me. What it was that you could probably guess. I mean, God, these days everybody knows these things. I was afraid of confronting my father and coming to the realization of his inadequacies, okay? My psychoanalyst, I write a book on the Critique of Pure Reason in which I say, Kant he's the greatest philosopher who ever lived, and he has an argument that is a powerful, coherent argument, and I'm the first person in the world who has succeeded in finding it, and here it is. And my analyst said to me, I said, you know, I had taken Kant as my substitute father figure. And my analyst pointed out to me that you think that Kant is the greatest philosopher who has ever lived, but that he needs you to for people to know what he means, which suggests that there's some inadequacy in him that only you can make up. So what was the next book I wrote? In Defense of Anarchism, which says essentially there are no fathers. And not only are there no fathers, there can be no fathers. It's logically impossible that there can be fathers. Well, so much for that. Then I could go on to become a father myself. Anyway, needless to, I go on forever this way, but then that's the way Freud goes on. Now, as Freud worked, he began to develop a very complex and deep theory about what goes on in the small child, where these wishes are coming from, and most particularly, why in some people this unconscious material does not erupt into symptomology and paralysis and blindness and agoraphobia and all sorts of other terrible afflictions for which they come to his office for relief, but why in some people that does happen. Now, before I go on, I want to caution you about something. Freud was quite clear about this, but people tend to forget it. Freud did not think that what he was offering was a theory of everything or a cure to everything. Freud thought that he was offering a theory of the human personality and its development that would serve as a technique, as the basis of a technique for curing certain kinds of ailments, the ones he called neuroses, just so we know what we're talking about. There were all sorts of other psychological ailments, psychoses so-called, paranoid schizophrenia or bimodal personality and so forth, which Freud thought psychoanalysis could do nothing for. They were not caused in the same way that neuroses were caused. They couldn't be treated in the same way, and he didn't think that what he was doing could offer any relief for them. It's very important to keep that in mind, because sometimes people object to Freud's theories on the ground that, well, he can't do anything about a paranoid schizophrenic, to which the answer is he didn't think he could, and with good reason. At any rate, let me introduce. This is going to be the subject, in effect, of the entire next lecture, what Freud found out and the theories that he developed. Let me just introduce this notion by reminding you of something which you all know, but which you may not have thought a lot about. The higher mammals, as we call them, ferrets, lions, dogs, not cats. Cats are another breed entirely. I don't think they count as higher mammals or anything else. They are just manifestations of disapproving gods, but that's neither here nor there. Mammals normally develop steadily. They grow. They develop sexually until they reach sexual maturity, at which point they reproduce. And that process takes a year, 2 years, 3 or 4 years. I read somewhere that elephants are only ready to reproduce at age 10, which, given how long they live, may very well be true. But it's a steady process of sexual development, leading physically to sexual maturity, at which point the animal is capable of reproducing. Not humans. Freud said. Not humans. Humans, and apparently only humans, have a kind of interrupted development, which is quite odd, and which is the physical basis for a great deal of what Freud was talking about. As we shall see next time, Freud concluded that little babies develop sexually for about 5 or 6 years until they reach a point at which they are emotionally, psychologically ready for reproduction, but not physically ready for reproduction. The little girls are not yet ovulating. The little boys are not yet producing sperm. What happens then, as we'll see, he concluded, was that a strange latency period, as he called it, is introduced, a period of 6, 7, 8 years, after which this is the, for those of you who are about to become parents or have become parents, you will recognize these years as the good years. After the hard years and before they get to the point where they're asking for the car. These are the fun years when you can take vacations with them and they don't complain in the car on the way to the vacation, when they seem rather relaxed and happy if you've done your parenting well. And then when they get older, after this period, around 11 or 12 or 13, then they develop physically in a way that is compatible with the psychological development that had already taken place by 5 or 6, and they are now mature mammals ready to reproduce. And that interrupted development lies at the basis of a good deal that is most complicated in Freud's theory of sexuality and his theory of the structure of the unconscious. Now, I'm going to stop there because next time I want to start, very oddly, by talking about David Hume. David Hume, God bless him, never got married, and I don't suppose after he was old enough to put on short pants, he never saw a little baby again in his life. But in part 4 of book 1 of A Treatise of Human Nature, David Hume gives a magnificent description of the psychological development of the very early child, which leads to the point at which the child forms the notion of objects, continued and independently existing objects, which is a part of the general psychological process by which the newborn turns into a recognizable human being and eventually a recognizable adult. What Hume missed, not surprisingly, is that the process is also entirely sexualized. But that's okay, because there's a lot more going on than sex. And what's going on is actually everything that leads to the development of the full-blown human mind. And that is what Freud was trying to figure out and unpack. Always remember, trying to do this with the reports, the free associations, the dreams, the symptoms, the responses of adult patients. It is, when you think about it, astonishing that Freud managed to figure out so much without ever looking at children. His daughter did, Anna Freud. I got to tell you, I'll end by telling you a marvelous story about Anna Freud, which I have from my sister, my big sister Barbara, who's about 4 inches shorter than I am, but she's 3.5 years older than I am. There's a whole story as to why I say she's 3.5 years older and not 3 years older, but that's another matter entirely about neuroses of mine, which I won't go into. My sister went to Swarthmore College, and she was taking a course with a friend of hers, and they were reading things by Anna Freud about child psychology. Anna Freud, Freud's daughter, became a very famous child psychiatrist. And they read Anna Freud's description of a patient she had had, a little boy, and what had happened to him. And this friend of my sister, who was sitting next to her, a guy named Lou Weiner, suddenly burst out, "But that's me!" And everybody looked at him and said, "What do you mean, that's me? That's you?" He said, "I'm that kid. I remember my parents took me to see a psychiatrist, and I'm that kid." What she had done was to change the names and so forth, but her description was quite accurate as to what happened to him. And he actually remembered having gone to this psychiatrist, whom he didn't know she was Freud's daughter, he was just the doctor. And the doctor interacted with him in various ways and then talked about it and analyzed the case in this article. And there was the kid all grown up now, and he was the kid. But Freud managed to do this without looking at children, just looking at grown-up adults and talking with them. And remember, I emphasize this over and over again, seeking always to relieve their suffering, to find what it was that was causing these otherwise neurologically inexplicable problems that they were presenting. That was for him always the touchstone of truth or falsehood, of success or failure. Now, next time I will get to the third and fourth questions. What is the content of the unconscious? What can we learn about what resides in the unconscious? I've already started talking about that. And then, what are the laws or rules that govern the way in which the materials of the unconscious function? And is there any way in which those laws or rules are different from the laws or rules governing conscious thinking? The answer to that is yes, in lots of ways. And that's actually a quite fascinating story. But that's enough for today. I've told you, I bared my soul to you to show you what Freud was doing. Now go out and do it yourselves.